All the viewers, this is Majesty Christian Television Network, and I believe that you enjoy the preaching from Mr. Class Mullins, who was able to tell us some of the miracles that took place in the Acts of the Apostles. I believe some of you must have been reading the book of Acts of the Apostles without taking cognizance of the miracles that took place, would be able to get in some of the facts, the way it happened, and the miracles that took place in that imprisonment of Peter. I thank you so much for being with us today.
It's a pleasure.
Right, for a little bit of introduction, Mr. Class Mullins was born in 1957. He became a Christian at the age of 18 and married in 1977 with Anneke, and together they have three daughters, three son-in-laws, and five grandchildren.
You're well informed.
Yeah. Awesome, awesome. So he joined Open Doors in 1978, celebrated 35 years with the mission last month. He has traveled all over the world to meet with persecuted believers and have heard many stories from them. He got arrested for Bible ministry in Russia, and at present he is a spokesman for OD Holland. Mm-hmm. Welcome once again to our studio.
Great.
So now, tell us, what is it about persecuted Christians that gets you tickling?
That I could talk for that for hours.
Please tell us.
Because we find persecuted Christians all over the world.
Yeah.
I've met them in many countries.
Yeah.
And you know, we're talking about people who have been arrested for believing in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about people whose churches have been burned.
Yes.
We're talking about people who have been imprisoned for many, many years.
Yes.
We're talking about people who have been praying for a Bible for many years and finally got a copy of it.
Yes.
So we're talking about 100 million Christians around the world who are being harassed and persecuted.
Yes.
And listening to them is so exciting.
Wow.
It's so encouraging. Because when they start talking,
mm-hmm.
It is so impressive what God is doing today.
Yes.
Let me give you an example. I was talking to a brother from Laos.
Laos
is a country where the church is being persecuted severely.
Wow.
And this man, he was very shy.
Mm-hmm.
When he started talking to us, he was looking at the ground. He was too shy to look us in the eye.
Why?
Because he felt himself being a simple rice farmer.
Okay.
And he looked at us from the West and he thought, well, you know, what could my story be to them?
Okay.
But then, his very first sentence was, while he was looking at the floor,
yes,
he was saying, I've been arrested for 13 times because of the gospel.
Wow. 13 times?
13 times. And then he immediately got my attention, and he said that the last time I was arrested for believing Christ, for sharing the gospel of Christ, the last time I was arrested, I was put in prison for 2.5 years. He said they gave me rice mixed with sand to eat.
Oh.
Yes. He said I was mistreated. I was yelled at day in, day out. He said, I was yelled at with a special title. They were calling me the Jesus man. Can you imagine?
Really?
So every time they scolded him, they were mentioning the name of Jesus inside the prison. They were calling
wow.
me the Jesus so man. This shy man. Can you imagine?
Really?
So every time they scolded him, around him, they were mentioning the name of Jesus man. They were calling
wow.
me the Jesus
so
man. This shy man, you imagine, the guards came up to him.
Really?
So every time they scolded him, around him, they were mentioning the name of Jesus man. They were calling
him
the Jesus man. Your religion, Christianity, does not belong to Laos. It's a foreign religion. You should stop with believing Christ.
Yes.
You should stop going to church.
Yes.
You sign this form that you promise that you will never go to church again.
Wow.
Now this man, he was talking to us, very shy.
Yes.
But he has a Shekinah glory around him,
yes.
which is amazing.
Amazing.
Amazing. He was mistreated badly. And he told me that when I came out of the prison, I could hardly walk because of the mistreatment.
Oh, God.
And he said, then I came home. My house was being confiscated. My rice field was gone. And later on, I found my wife and kids somewhere in a forest. And then I asked him, but brother, how can you cope with all of this?
Yes.
Isn't it too much? All this suffering, all this persecution, how can you deal with it?
Yes. And what did he say?
And this is what gets me thinking about the persecuted church.
Yes.
He says, I have fixed my eyes on the Eternal One, on Jesus.
Amen.
I'm not looking at the circumstances.
God Almighty.
Actually, everything was taken away from
this
him.
This is awesome.
His health has been taken away from him. His freedom.
Yes.
His possessions.
Yes.
The only thing he had left was his relationship with God.
Yes.
With Jesus inside.
This is
and
awesome.
He said, I have fixed my eyes on the Eternal
this
One.
This is awesome. This is awesome. And this is happening in this our modern time.
This is happening today.
Because, you know, when the concept of persecution is being spoken of, or when people are going through persecution, it's like Christians even look at whoever is going through persecution as if they've done something extraordinary.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they look at them. When people are going through persecution,
mm-hmm.
sometimes others look at them as if, oh, there's sin in your life. That's why you are suffering.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand me?
Mm-hmm.
So they don't, it's like we are, I don't know where we have embraced this gospel of not being persecuted. But the whole Bible talks about persecution.
You know what? I have a promise for us and all, for all the viewers as
yes.
well.
Yes.
Because you know what the promise in the Bible says?
Tell me.
And now I hope I don't scare the viewers.
No. It will make us to sit up.
Because you know what it says in the Bible?
Mm-hmm.
It says that everybody who wants to believe in God, who is God-fearing,
mm-hmm.
he will be persecuted.
Exactly. That's the word.
So that's not about sin.
They count it a thing of joy when you are being persecuted for
true.
The sake
exactly.
of the,
you know,
for righteousness' sake.
It, the Chinese Christians, you know what they say? They mm-hmm. say, persecution is part of the normal Christian life. We in the West, we are very comfortable.
We are too
in
comfortable.
Our churches.
Yes.
We have everything.
Yes.
And sometimes we hardly don't need God anymore because
exactly.
we can take care of it ourselves.
Wow.
But the persecuted believers, they teach us that persecution is part of the normal Christian life.
It is true.
Yeah. Actually, even the Lord Jesus promised.
Mm-hmm.
They have persecuted me.
And so would they persecute us.
They will. So that's why we have to, like this brother from Laos,
yes.
fix our eyes on Jesus.
Yes.
Because he will pull us through. Actually, there's a wonderful promise. Do you imagine? It gets me taking this subject. because it says in the book of Peter
yes.
that those are being scolded. The Spirit of God and the Spirit of glory rests
upon
them.
Yes.
So there is no matter of sin in their lives. No, it is light and darkness fighting with each other.
So what you are saying is that when people are going through persecution, that the Spirit of glory rests upon them.
Absolutely.
So in diverse situations believers are going through, they have to believe that is a mark of the glory of God resting
mm-hmm.
upon them.
True.
And not just that it is the devil putting them through that.
No, true. It obviously devil is involved, but God is stronger.
Yes.
And he is carrying his people through.
Amen.
And then it
awesome.
Can happen.
Awesome, awesome.
God's testimony is being
wow.
heard in prison.
Wow.
Yeah.
So from your experience, in what part of the world have people been mostly persecuted?
Well, we are talking about 60 countries today.
60?
Yes, and we're talking about 100 million Christians. We're talking about countries like Colombia in Latin America. But we're talking about many African countries. We're talking about countries in the Middle East.
Yes.
We're talking about countries in Asia. And of course, most of all, in North Korea. There is a country where there is no obvious church. Only an underground church.
Underground.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking about 60 countries. I have a map here behind me.
Yes.
I can show it.
Show us, please.
Because then you can see, of course, the marked countries with red are all countries with Christian persecution.
Wow!
Here you see Colombia,
yeah.
Africa countries, Middle East, Asia, and the Far East. And there are more than 60 countries and over 100 million believers being persecuted for simply being a Christian.
Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
So why is the name of Jesus such a threat to them?
Because the name of Jesus makes people uncomfortable. Because you either accept Christ
mm-hmm.
or you deny Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Immediately you are there to make a choice. And many people, they
awesome.
Don't accept Christ. They refuse him because
yes.
They don't see how glorious Christ is to us. How wonderful things he has done for us.
Yes.
Heaven has come down to earth.
You know why I had why I'm asking this question is you've been exposed to so many millions of people, so many Christians are being persecuted. I'm sure they may have told you in your process of interviewing them
mm-hmm.
why the name of Jesus is being is a threat to their government or to those who are persecuting mm-hmm. them.
Because, you know, coming back to this example from Laos,
mm.
of course, Laos is a Buddhist country.
Yes.
And when the name of Jesus is being preached,
yes.
it rocks their world. Because they prefer to stay within Buddhism.
Yes.
But Buddhism does not give them any salvation.
Yes.
Does
yes.
not give them any hope.
So in other words, they don't want the truth to be discussed.
That people are being
caged.
They are caught in darkness.
Yes.
And when the name of Jesus is being preached,
yes.
then the darkness is just holding on in the grip of many people.
Wow.
So we need to pray that light will enter their darkness.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh, somebody who is out there listening to us. This is very, very interesting for us to know that there are thousands of Christians that have been persecuted in 60 countries. 100 million Christians have been persecuted. So if you are watching this program and then you have the Bible at your disposal and you can go to church freely and you can hear the word of God or talk about Jesus freely, it is a very good time to say thank you, to appreciate the freedom you have mm-hmm. in enjoying Christ. Mm-hmm. And if you are out there, maybe you are in one of these countries, we want you to know that Jesus is on the way for you.
Mm.
You will not be persecuted to death. And even if you are being persecuted to death, you will know that greater is your reward.
Mm. Hmm. Can I say something about, you said about the Bible?
Yeah,
To appreciate that. I remember that we came in Russia.
Yes.
And we had brought in Bibles into the country.
Mm-hmm.
And we met a lady, she was about 60 years old.
Yes.
She had been praying for years to finally get her first copy of the Bible.
Wow.
And we gave her a Bible.
Yes.
And she was very thankful, very polite. She said, thank you. Спасибо, she said in Russian. But then, something beautiful happened. She opened the booklet,
mm-hmm.
and then she found out that it was the Bible. The word of God she has been praying for so many years.
Yes.
And you know, her eyes turned big, this big.
Yes.
And then she did something very unexpected. She closed the book like this.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you know what she did?
No.
She brought it to her mouth and she
kissed it. Oh, yeah. Awesome.
And you know, that is awesome. a lesson for me.
Yes.
To appreciate this precious word of God. And I hope also the viewers
mm-hmm.
agree with what you said.
Yes.
To say thank you to God.
We should.
We should honestly. Actually all be kissing our Bibles.
Oh, yes.
Don't you think?
It's true. Yeah, I think so too. I think
yeah.
so.
Yeah.
I think so because in it is the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
In it is life. In it is that which would take one out from darkness, you know, mm-hmm. that would the Bible is too much. That's, I don't know how to describe it than to use the word too much.
Because
it's the word of God. It's living. Mm-hmm. It's powerful. It's authentic. It's solid.
Mm-hmm.
It is that which will never fail. You know, from childhood, I've read some books, and today I can't see those books anymore. But the Bible have been there from age to age, and it will remain the same. The Bible said the word of God is forever settled.
Amen.
So we have every reason to kiss it,
mm-hmm,
and to appreciate it, and to value it.
Yeah.
We have every reason to invest in it. There are some Christians out there who go to church every Sunday. They have no Bible.
Mm-hmm.
You see, they are not proud of it.
Yeah.
But here you met a woman that was too proud of the Bible, waiting for 60 solid years before she could get the first Bible.
Yeah.
May God bless you, sir.
Yeah. But imagine that in a country like North Korea, it is so dangerous to have a Bible that people, when they have read it, they dig a hole in the floor, in their garden.
And bury it.
And they put it in plastic and they bury it. And next time they want to read it, they dig it out.
Oh, Jesus.
They read it, put it in a plastic bag together and put it in the soil again. Because when they are caught reading,
yes,
they will be imprisoned for life.
God Almighty.
So there is a huge price around the Bible.
Yes.
About mentioning the name of Jesus.
Yes.
So what a blessing it is,
that
Majesty is here,
Lord,
to preach the gospel, to proclaim
Lord,
the name of Jesus around the world.
We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And that's one thing about Majesty. You know, when God spoke to us to open up Majesty, to go into this broadcasting network, we didn't know how to do it. But somehow along the line, He continued to tell us that everything that we will need for Majesty is within our disposal. He said, your husband is an information technologist. He knows many things.
Mm-hmm.
He said he will use his experience. So one time, my husband and I, when we were fasting, and then he came in one morning, he told me, one evening, I beg your pardon, he said, honey, I've discovered something. I said, how? He said, I can see that I can mix this and mix that, and things are beginning to appear on the screen. I said, what do you mean? He said, come. He followed him. He said, look at this. I watched him. He mixed something, and something was appearing on the screen. It was me. I said, how did you do it? He said, I don't know. The Lord is directing him, do this and do this. And then before you know it, Majesty, whoops, became a network. He said, you know what? We are dedicating it to the preaching of the gospel all over the world. And then we are very glad that wherever people are now in different parts of the world, they can watch, they can hear the word of God. What we are talking here will go all over the world. People can hear and know that that persecution is part of the package. I'm so excited that we are talking about persecution today, because it's like we have diluted the gospel so much that we only talk about personal enhancement. We talk about 7 steps to miracle, 7 steps to getting married, 7. We don't talk about persecution anymore. Yeah. So I'm so delighted to meet someone like you who is so committed in this project that you are doing. And then comforting those who have been persecuted. May God richly bless you, sir.
Thank you.
So tell our listeners a little bit about this Open Door. Why did you choose that name, Open Door, for your ministry?
You know, the ministry started in 1955 with Brother Andrew. He is a Dutchman. And he was in a Bible school. And all the students, they went to Western countries to preach the gospel. But he found out that none of them went to Eastern Europe.
Mm-hmm.
So he went to Eastern Europe and came in touch with the church. And the church pastors told him, you know, it's so great that you're here. You're an answer to our prayers. Because we have often been forgotten. We have often thought not even God is thinking of me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But that you've come was such an encouragement. Now please come back, and when you come back, take with you Polish Bibles.
Yes.
Because we don't have them. We can't import them, we can't print them, it's forbidden.
Yeah.
And that's how the ministry of Open Doors began in 1955.
Okay.
And from the very beginning, Brother Andrew, then in Warsaw in Poland, he read from scriptures, Revelations 3:2,
mm-hmm.
It says, awake, and strengthen what remains and is at the point of death.
Yes.
And with that verse, God was calling him into ministry to strengthen what was at the point of death.
Yeah.
But also, reading a little bit further, he says that God has given you an open door that no one can shut.
Amen.
And since that time, the ministry is called Open Doors. We cannot accept that any government is putting up a hindrance for the gospel.
Yes.
We will not accept that there will be a closed door for the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Okay.
So that's why the name of Open Doors. Yeah.
Wow. So let's assume that you are being confronted by some governments that want to close up the door against the gospel. What do you do?
Well, what we have been doing for dozens of years now, then we go in secretly. Then we go in a secret way.
Yes.
And we find a back door to enter the country.
Okay.
In order to meet the church, to talk to them, to encourage them.
Yes.
And to encourage them with Bibles, with Christian books, with training, with lots of practical help. So we our DNA is that we do not accept a closed door.
Yes.
Yes, because God has given us an open door that no one can shut. There is no one stronger than our God.
Amen.
So no one can close the door.
Wow, awesome. So what sort of churches do you normally encourage? Is there denominations? I mean, like, is it Catholics or Pentecostals? Or what sort of denominations do you...
Well, we are mostly talking about Protestant churches.
Okay.
And everybody.
Yes.
So nobody excluded.
Yes.
And sometimes we even help Catholic and Orthodox believers as well.
Mm-hmm.
When they ask us for scriptures, of course we want to help them.
Yes.
Because we want to help every persecuted believer to grow in Christ and to grow in the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So our materials are aimed to that. Our training is aimed to that.
Yes.
Actually, our training is also used to train persecuted believers to cope with persecution.
Wow.
What does the Bible say about it? And how can they learn from others as well? Yeah, so that's what our ministry is all about.
It's awesome. It's a very powerful ministry.
Mm-hmm.
My God, I think Jesus will be so much glad with you people.
Well, I certainly hope so.
Yeah, I think so. That is where his heartbeat is.
Mm-hmm,
because
true.
If everybody would just sit in a closed door and or church and they'd be just breeding 100 people and whatever, you know, because many preachers are just interested in just those in their church. They don't look beyond.
Mm-hmm.
But your ministry is something very fabulous.
Well, we pray every day. Every day we start with prayer and Bible reading,
mm-hmm.
also in our office, because, you know, we need God to work.
Yes, exactly.
We cannot do it in our own strength. We are much dependent on Him.
Mm-hmm.
And we certainly believe that the Lord is thankful for our ministry.
Yes.
And that's our prayers also, that everything we do and say will be glorifying His name.
Amen. Wait a minute. How do you get in touch with the churches or the people who are persecuted? Who informs you? Is it the people themselves or you get a mail? How do you come in contact with them?
It's by simply visiting them.
No. How do you come in contact with them? How do they call you people?
Mm-hmm. Well, when there is no contact at all.
Yeah.
We sometimes visit the country and go through the country in prayer.
Yes.
Sometimes persecuted Christians come to our countries for a conference, for example, and we meet here. So there are many ways to get in touch with each other. And then from then on, a relationship grows for years of visiting, encouragement, back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
And slowly from that relationship onwards, we get requests for Bibles, for books, for whatever. And we try to often smuggle them in, get them in secretly.
Yes.
Because when authorities forbid us to do so,
yes,
we say, well, but the Lord has given us an open door. And who are you to shut it?
Amen.
We do not accept that.
Yes.
Of course, we acknowledge good governments. And we want to obey them.
Mm-hmm.
But when governments start persecuting the church, then we have the right to go in secretly and help the church in whatever way.
So since you were born again, you were 18, mm-hmm. you've been busy with it.
Well, I actually started with Open Doors working there at age of 20.
Yes.
So
till now.
Till now.
Awesome.
Yeah. And that has been.
Give me five. You work so hard.
It's a wonderful.
This is awesome.
A wonderful blessing.
Yes, it is. Yeah. It is, because even as you are explaining it to me, I can feel the joy of the Lord everywhere. I can feel God being well pleased with the work you are doing.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, more grace, mm-hmm. more grace! Wow. So, what advice, or what do you think the modern day church should know about believers who are being persecuted?
Well, a very good question, and let me quote scripture to you.
Yeah, I do.
Because it says in the book of Corinthians, the 1 Corinthians chapter 12,
mm-hmm.
in verse 26, it mm-hmm. says. If one part suffers,
mm-hmm.
all Could members do. Suffer with it.
It's true.
And if one part is honored,
yes,
all the others can rejoice with it. And there it says that in the church, we are actually one body.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just, it's not believers in Africa only.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's believers in Latin America, Europe, Asia, Middle East, Africa. All together, we are one body.
Yes.
And the Bible says we are the body of Christ.
Yes, we are.
So we are one body. That means we are connected with each other.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I sometimes compare that with a simple example from the work in the kitchen. Yes. If I am cooking,
yeah,
and if I put my hand on a hot pan,
yes,
on the stove,
yes.
What happens to my hand?
It will burn.
It will burn.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is, you know, my fingers are just a small part of my body. They don't really belong to the body because my head and my... But when I burn my fingers on that hot pan,
it will affect.
Suddenly mm-hmm. the whole body is involved. You know what? A signal goes from my fingertips, goes through my arm, to my... brain, and it says there is pain in the body somewhere, and suddenly there's a signal going to the mouth saying you should go ouch, and suddenly another signal goes back to the hand, retreat. And another signal goes back to the fingers and say let this wound recover.
Yeah.
So suddenly the whole body is involved.
It's true.
With pain somewhere in the uttermost parts of the body.
Yeah.
And that's how it should be also in the church.
Yes.
If one member of us suffer, we should jump in to encourage, to lift this person's burden.
It's true.
But also, when there is joy, mm-hmm. we should also share that with each other. So, because of that Bible verse, everybody in the church should be involved with believers elsewhere.
Yes.
So it should not only be that we are rejoicing of what's happening in our lives.
Exactly.
We should be concerned about our brothers and sisters in persecution.
Precise. Yeah. Precise. That is what it's supposed to be. Oh, so how can other Christians support the work of Open Door?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, viewers can be involved with the work of Open Doors by visiting our websites.
Okay.
Opendoors.nl in Holland, Open Doors UK, opendoorsusa.org, by visiting websites, by getting information, by simply reading in your home about the work of Open Doors, and by praying. And as I mentioned from the book of Acts chapter 12,
mm-hmm.
when people start praying, wonderful things will happen.
Yes.
Then a brother in Laos can stand firm.
Yes.
Despite all the persecution.
Amen.
Because we stand united in the body.
This is awesome.
To pray for each other.
Yes.
So getting information is the first thing.
Mm-hmm.
Praying is another thing.
Mm-hmm.
And people can, of course, be involved with many other aspects of the ministry. But I would advise them to visit our website. Websites around the world.
Yes.
All of our bases have different websites. Open Doors,
Kundos.nl. So
yes.
If you are here listening to this broadcast, you are residing in the Netherlands, then you can go to www.opendoors.nl.
Exactly.
And if you are in United States, you can go to www.opendoors.org.
Yes, I think opendoorsusa.org. Yeah.
Open Doors. Yeah, you can just check it out. Just go to one website, I believe. If you can get just to one website, the one of NL, then you can get the other ones as well.
True.
Okay. So in case somebody will want to join the organization, well, how would they do it?
Well, also by visiting the website.
Okay.
And then they can subscribe to our magazine.
Yes.
And then we can send them prayer items, whatever. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So before we sign up, look into the camera and please just encourage somebody who is watching out there, maybe going through one persecution or the other, or about to make a decision for Christ. Could you please look at the camera
mm-hmm.
and just encourage them before
sure.
we sign up?
Sure. Dear brother and sister, thank you so much for watching this this program. This is not a coincidence.
Mm-hmm.
This is God's timing for you today.
Yes.
And I want to bless you right now with the peace of God
Jesus.
To enter your lives.
Yes, Lord.
With encouragement.
Yes, Lord.
That He has not forgotten you.
Yes, Lord.
He is with you right now in your home,
Amen.
in your room.
Yes, Lord.
And He is blessing you right now.
Yes.
I'm lifting up my hand to bless
yes,
you
yes,
in
Lord.
The name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
So that there will be release in your life.
Yes.
That the power of prayer will do a miracle in your life.
Yes.
And thank you for watching and being eager to learn, and I hope that you will be reading the Word of God. Get a copy, buy it,
yes.
and experience the peace of the Lord in your lives.
Amen.
And may the Lord bless you, and yes. keep on watching to this show.
Yes.
Also today and tomorrow and the days to come.
Yes.
And you will be encouraged in your life with God.
Amen. Thank you so much for being with us, and we appreciate it. Thanks once again, and we would like
Welcome.
To have you more and more and more. Well, outsiders and viewers, this has been an interview with Mr. Klaas Mullins of Open Door Ministries. We spoke today about persecution. Should you want to listen or hear more about this, so go to that website, www.opendoor.nl. Or just go to manchestertv.org. You can still watch this broadcast. By the way, it will be on YouTube in the next 2 hours, so you can also watch it. God richly bless you, and we thank you for tuning in. Bye.